Thank you very much for this kind introduction, and also I would like to thank all of the organizers for inviting me here to this workshop in Sendai. I feel very honored to have the opportunity to present my current research here in this summer school. What I would like to do in this lecture is to consider the usual Navier-Stokes equation in some domain with compact boundary, that means in some bounded domain, or I will focus on the case of an exterior domain. And in the Navier-Stokes equation, we have some right-hand side F, so some external force. The solution U should be solenoidal, so the divergence should be equal to zero. We have some initial value U naught, and that's the main part. The function U should be equal to some function beta on the boundary. So we were considering this problem with non-homogeneous Jellicoe boundary data. And I would like to do in the end is to answer the question if a weak solution to this equation tends to zero in the L2 norm if time goes to infinity. And therefore, of course, if I would like to discuss the decay of weak solution, I have to define the notion of a weak solution to this equation. And we will see that during the definition of weak solution to this equation, we have to deal with the solutions to the Stokes equation, or to be more precise, we have to deal with the notion of a very weak solution to the Stokes equation. And since this is somehow not so common concept, I will define the notion of a very weak solution to the Stokes equation. And then it will turn out that during the discussion of the decay properties, it will be important if you have, let's say, some control about how the solution is constructed. And therefore, it's important to know how you can construct a weak solution to this problem, and therefore we'll say some words about the existence theory of weak solution to this equation run over here. And finally, as I already mentioned, I would like to discuss the decay properties, and there we have to focus on two different cases, of course, on the bounded domain case and the exterior domain case, but we also have to focus on the case where the solution is constructed as we want them to be constructed, or we just start with an arbitrary turbulent solution, which means a weak solution which fulfills a strong energy inequality. And let me say, I'll tell you some historical background. This decay problem was first posed by Liray in his famous paper in the 1930s. Of course, in this case, for homogeneous Jellicoe boundary data. But even if you consider the linear equation, that means the Stokes equation, so the convective term is neglected, then it's quite difficult to answer if a weak solution tends to zero in the L2 norm as time goes to infinity. In the exterior domain case, it was answered by Masuda about 30 years ago, but at least to my knowledge, it is not known how fast a solution to the Stokes equation with initial value U naught tends to zero as time goes to infinity. So also in the end, if you see some decay theorems or decay rate theorems, there's also always the assumption that the solution to the Stokes equation tends to zero as T to some power. Okay. For the case that the force is equal to zero and, of course, that the boundary value is equal to zero, this problem was studied in the exterior domain case by Borges and Miyakawa in 1991. And in some sense, we will reprove their theorems in a more general setting. And finally, let me just mention that the existence of turbulent solution to this equation was proved in 2014 by Favik and Cozono. And in some sense, this is the starting point of our considerations to this decay problem to turbulent solutions. Okay, how can we define a weak solution to this to our equation of the Navier-Stokes equation with non-homogeneous boundary data? Therefore, let us start with the solution B to the Stokes equation. The solution should be equal to zero on the right-hand side, so there is no external force. The solution, of course, should be solenoidal. The initial value should be equal to zero, but we have some non-homogeneous boundary data, beta. So the function B solution to the Stokes equation should be equal to some function beta on the boundary. And then we can consider the function V defined as U minus B. U is a solution to the Navier-Stokes equation, B is a solution to the Stokes equation, and then we see that V is a solution to an equation, I would say, of Navier-Stokes type or a perturbed Navier-Stokes equation, where the nonlinear term is a little bit different. But of course, there's the same right-hand side F as for the solution to the Navier-Stokes equation U. The solution V is still solenoidal. We have still the same initial value U naught. But and there's the advantage. We have to deal with some homogeneous boundary data. So the function V is equal to the to zero on the boundary. And just for simplicity, let me rewrite this nonlinear term in the usual divergence form, which you can do since V and B are solenoidal. We can rewrite this V plus B times gradient of V plus B as a divergent of this tensor product. Okay, for the next slide, let me just copy the equation 3, and but the nonlinear term is rewritten in this divergence form. Then we have this equation 3 prime over here. And now it's easy to define the notion of a weak solution to the equation 3 or to the equation 3 prime. This is just a function V in the Layer-Hopf class. So it should be L infinity in time with values in L2 sigma in space, such that the gradient is bounded in L2, L2. And the equation 3 or 3 prime should hold in the distributional or variational sense. And finally, we assume that V fulfills the energy inequality. We will see the energy inequality in a minute. What is the advantage of just to consider the notion of a weak solution to the equation 3 instead of the equation 1, so the Navier-Stokes equation with non-homogeneous boundary data? Of course, we have homogeneous boundary data, and that's much more easier. But there's another advantage. If you look at this equation 3 prime over here, and then what we would like to do in a variational formulation is to test this equation with some psi and to integrate by parts. And after we did this, there's no term with gradient of B left. So we just need information about the integrability of B, not about the integrability of some gradient of the solution to the Stokes equation. So this leads to the advantage that we can deal with a very large class of boundary values betas, or solutions to the Stokes equation B. So in some sense, this concept is a little bit more general than to deal directly with this equation 1. Of course, there's also a disadvantage. We have to deal with a more complicated nonlinear term, right? It's more than V times gradient V. And after I discussed the notion of a very weak solution to the Stokes equation, I will just assume that the solution to the Stokes equation B is some part of the data. So I will assume that B is some part of the data, not this boundary value beta. And what we have to assume to discuss the notion of a weak solution to this equation 3 prime is, on one hand, that B is an L4, L4. Why do we have to do this? Of course, in doing some procedure of construction, we would like to test this equation itself by some approximate solution. Of course, we cannot test it with the solution itself, but in some approximate process, we can do that. And there are some tricks to deal with the term V times gradient VV during this process of approximation. But we have to assume that every other term, so this BVV and BBV, is an L1, L1. And therefore, we have to assume that B squared is an L2, L2, or B is an L4, L4. And we have to assume, furthermore, that the term B times V is an L2, L2, and that B is in some LS0, LQ0 space, where 2 over S0 plus 3 over Q0 is equal to 1, so in some Serrin class. And finally, let me say that the force F should be the divergent of some capital F, where capital F is an L2, L2. So the usual setting for weak solutions to the Navier-Stokes equation. Okay, I already told you that we would like to discuss the notion of a very weak solution to the Stokes equation. So we just have information about the integrability of the solution B to the Stokes equation. And this function should be equal to some function beta on the boundary. And in some sense, this might be a problem, because if you're just in Lebesgue spaces or Buchner spaces, we do not have a trace operator in general, because the boundary, of course, is a null set. And so it's not possible in general to define what it means that the function B, which is just in some LSLQ space, is equal to beta on the boundary. But there we have the theorem of Green, that we can rewrite, at least for smooth function B and a smooth function psi, the orthonormal B times n tested with psi, just integrated over the boundary of omega, by the divergence of B times psi plus B times the gradient of psi. That's just a theorem of Green. And the right-hand side, we can define for a large class of function B and functions psi. In fact, we could define this for all psi in W1Q prime and B in AQ, such that the divergence is in some LR space, where R and Q fulfills this relation over there. And so we can give the left-hand side a meaning, or this B times N a meaning, in the dual space of W1 minus 1 Q in of the boundary of omega, or we can give the meaning B times N, the normal component of the function, B a meaning in a dual space of some trace space. And so therefore, we have a large class for possible boundary values. But we can just deal with the normal component of the boundary values. And of course, just if you have some control about the divergence of the solution to the Stokes equation, but we always have some control of the divergence because this function is equal to zero. Okay, and then it's very easy to define the notion of a very weak solution. It's just a function b in LSLQ, which fulfills the Stokes equation in a variational sense. And for this case, we would like to test this with all function w in C1 in time with values in C2 in space, which are solenoidal and which are smooth up to the boundary. So this is just a concept of very weak solution to the Stokes equation. And in some sense, you can construct very weak solution to the Stokes equation by a dual argument to the strong solvability of the Stokes equation. So since the strong solvability of the Stokes equation is very well developed, it's easy to define or to construct very weak solutions to the Stokes equation. Let us go back to the theory of existence to weak solution to the Navier or to the perturbed Navier-Stokes equation with homogeneous boundary data. I think the first theorem of existence was studied by Ammann in the 2000, but there were many, many more others considering the same problem. And I would like to cite a theorem by Fave, Cozzono, and Zhou, I think from 2012, where they proved the existence of weak solution to this equation. And they proved if you start with a domain in R3 with sufficiently smooth boundary, some right-hand side divergence of capital F, a capital F in L2, L2, and the solution to the Stokes equation is an L4, L4 with intersected with LS0, LQ0, then there exists a weak solution to this perturbed Navier-Stokes equation, which fulfills the energy inequality. And in this case, the energy inequality is like the usual energy inequality on the left-hand side. This 2, 2t means that we integrate an L2 in space, an L2 in time, so the first one is space, second one is time, and we integrate from 0 to t. And this can be estimated by the initial value plus the force plus some term which is connected to the nonlinear term. And furthermore, we have some energy estimate so that we can, of course, in this case, in the energy inequality, we have the function v also on the right-hand side. So if we would like to prove boundedness in the Levi-Hopf class, we need another estimate. This is this energy estimate I have written down in the last line, that you can estimate the Levi-Hopf class of v by, there's probably a constant missing, I don't know, plus terms on the data. So of U0, of the force capital F, of b in the L4, L4 norm, as well as b in the LS0, LQ0 norm. But you see here that there's a constant which is growing exponentially. So if you assume that you just start with a solution which exists in a finite time interval, and you know that the function b is, let's say, linearly growing in the S0, LQ0 norm, then that could happen that the solution in the Levi-Hopf class V has an exponentially growing term. So this energy estimate rate over here is quite bad. What is the idea of the proof of the weak solution, of the existence of weak solution? This will be important in the last proof of the decay estimate. Probably you can do everything you would like to do, every construction method you know for a solution to the Navier-Stokes equation also in this case. What they decided to consider is some smoothing process using the Yoshida approximation. So the operator identity plus 1 over m times the Stokes operator a to the power of minus 1 to smooth the nonlinear term. And then you can easily prove that this equation over there has a unique weak solution, which is also smooth, and which is bounded, which fulfills the energy inequality and the energy estimate. So it's bounded in the Levi-Hopf class, and you find a weak convergence subsequence in the space where the gradient is bounded in L2, L2, and some weakly star convergence subsequence in L infinity, L2, and some strongly convergent subsequence in every bounded subdomain in L2, L2, and all of those converges to a weak solution to our original problem. And there's also a theorem by Fabik and Cozzono where they proved that there are also weak solutions to this equation, to the perturbed Navier-Stokes equation, which fulfills the strong energy inequality. But therefore, you have to assume, at least in the exterior domain case, you have to assume a little bit more on the function B and the solution to the Stokes equation. In fact, you have to assume that you also have control about the gradient of B, or in other words, that B is a weak solution to the Stokes equation. And so far, I just discussed one concept of how to construct weak solution to this problem. by starting with a very weak solution to the Stokes equation. Of course, there are also another approaches. One of them is not to deal with the solution to the Stokes equation at all, just to construct a function b tilde, which fulfills this estimate over here, that you can estimate w1 times b tested with the gradient of w2 by some constant, in this case, for example, 1 over 4 times the gradient of w1 times the gradient of w2. If you have this estimate on hand and you have some additional integrability properties on b, something like f4 and at infinity with values in w12, and you have some information about the time derivative of b, you can prove also the existence of weak solution to the Perturb-Navier-Stokes equation, which fulfills a better energy estimate, like it's written down here. But of course, in this case, you cannot neglect the term the time derivative of b minus the depletion of b, which in some sense vanishes if you consider a solution to the Stokes equation. You have to put them on the right-hand side into the force capital F. So the way how you construct a solution and the estimate became a little bit different. What I would discuss in our theorems is the decay of weak solution to that problem. And therefore, let us start with the bounded domain case, and let us start with a suitable weak solution. What we proved is, if you're considering a weak, that there exists a weak solution, if the domain is bounded and sufficiently smooth, which tends to zero as time goes to infinity. And furthermore, if the data goes to zero exponentially, then we also proved that the solution tends to zero exponentially. And to be more precise, we measured here the L2 norm of the force F integrating from some alpha 1 to T to T, and the same for B in the L4 norm and B in the LS0 LQ0 norm. And if we assume that this tends to zero exponentially, then we prove that the solution tends to zero exponentially, where this exponentially constant, of course, depends on how fast the data goes to zero, so on this alpha 1 and this alpha 2, like you see over here, alpha 1 and alpha 2, and also on the domain, or to be more precise, on the Poincaré constant. What is the idea of the proof? I just told you that there exists a solution which tends to zero in the bounded domain. So you have some choice how you construct the weak solution, and of course it chose the same method like I already presented to you in the proof of existence. So you were using the smoothing process with the Yoshida approximation. And then you can prove that this approximate solution fulfills some differential inequality, like it's written over here. And then just by using Poincaré constant to rewrite this term in some rho times the L2 norm squared of Vk, and multiplying with some constant and integrating from 0 to t, you obtain this decay properties I have written down in the theory. And of course, let me just mention that if you're working in an axial domain, you have to start with a completely different proof because you cannot use Poincaré's inequalities. And this is quite important in the theory. And of course, this also works for just for suitable solution because you need this differential inequality over here, and we were not able to give them a meaning for a general weak solution. So here you need some more information about this how you construct the weak solution. So before I came to the part of the exterior domain case, let me just, the next thing we would like to do is to extend this theorem to an arbitrary turbulent solution. And the way how to do this is the following. What you have to do is just three steps. The first step is that we, after some time, u of t naught, so the weaks, so u should denote a turbulent solution to the Perturb-Navier-Stokes equation, that u of t naught is small in some appropriate norm I will define on the next slide. And then what we would like to do is to construct a suitable weak solution we already have constructed in the last theorem, which tends to zero as time goes to infinity. And then in the last step, we have to prove that this a turbulent solution and the suitable weak solution which decays coincide at least in the time interval from t naught to infinity. And so also our turbulent solution has the same decay properties. What's behind the step one? We know that u is in the Lehre-Hopf class. So for almost all times, t, u is in L2, and the gradient is in L2, or u is in L6 by Sobolev embeddings. And this space L2 intersected with L6 embeds in some space, which I will call the initial value space for serine-type strong solutions. Some sense in the right space to construct a strong solution. And since you have some more information that the gradient of u, or u in the L2, L6 norm, can be integrated, at least in L2 sense, in some sense, there are u of t's which are small in the norm of this initial value space for seven-type strong solutions. What's behind the step two? The step two is, of course, we can construct a weak solution which fulfills these decay properties just by our last theorem. But furthermore, we were able to construct a strong solution, at least in the interval from t naught to infinity. And then we can prove in the last step something like a seven-type uniqueness theorem, that you have a strong solution and a weak solution which fulfills the energy inequality, then those coincide. And of course, if you have this suitable weak solution which decays, we have this turbulent solution, and we can construct a strong solution, and all of them have to coincide, then also the turbulent solution has the same decay properties as the suitable weak solution. So just let me show you the theorems behind these three steps. But therefore, of course, I have to define the notion of a strong solution. A strong solution is just a weak solution with some additional integrability properties, so it should be in some LSLQ space, where LSLQ are connected with a Serre number. So 2 over S plus 3 over Q should be equal to 1. And I have to define the space for initial values more exactly. It's defined here by using the semigroup of the Stokes operator. And just by construction, this is the space for all initial values U naught, which has a strong solution to the Stokes equation. And there's one series of paper by Professor Favig and co-authors who prove that this is also the right initial value space for a strong solution in the sense of Serrin to the Navier-Stokes equation. Okay, and then we have this theorem about the existence of strong solutions. And this works for a bounded domain and for an exterior domain. And I think it was already proved in the bounded domain case a few years earlier, but we considered in our paper the exterior domain case. That, of course, if you assume that omega is a domain in R3 and the boundary is surfacely smooth, you have to assume that the initial value is in L2 sigma to construct a weak solution, as well as in the right space for the initial values for strong solutions. And you need some additional information about the force capital F, that this is in some space Ls not half with values in LQ not half. And then there exists an epsilon star, such that if the data is small enough in some time interval from 0 to t prime, so that the data is smaller than epsilon star, then there exists a unique strong solution in the time interval from 0 to t prime. And this is, of course, an existing theory for weeks, for locally in time. Just choose t prime small enough. But it's also a globally in time existence result if the data is small. Okay. What's the idea of the proof? It's also rather simple. Just rewrite the solution to our equation by a solution to the Stokes equation plus some w, which is a solution to a fixed point. So start with the solution v naught to the Stokes equation with the same initial value u naught and the force f. And then you consider this operator over here. And you can prove easily that a strong solution is a fixed point. It's v naught plus w, where w is a fixed point to this operator f over here. And in some sense, it is easy to prove that this operator has a fixed point in this LSLQ space. But the hard task is to prove that also the solution is in the Legge-Hopf class. At least in the exterior domain case here, you have to really to work to prove this. OK, and then we have some Serrin-type uniqueness theorem in our setting. I already told you about that. One more time, this works for a bounded domain and for the exterior domain case. We just assume that the boundary is surfacely smooth. And you start with a strong solution U and with a weak solution V, then both of them coincide. And just let me mention on this point, usually it's assumed that the weak solution has to fulfill the energy inequality, but we already assumed this in our definition. So there's no need to assume this one more time, writing down the theorem, of course. Okay, but now we have everything in hand to prove the same decay properties, like for the suitable weak solution, for an arbitrary turbulent solution. In fact, if you assume everything like in the case of the bounded domain for the suitable weak solution, and assume more that at least after some time t, the force is in the right space to construct a strong solution, so in some Ls not over s not half with radius in LQ not half, then we were able to do all of these three steps. And so we were able to prove that also the turbulent solution has the same decay properties like the suitable weak solution. So the solution tends to zero as time goes to infinity. And furthermore, if you assume that the data goes to zero exponentially, then we were able to prove that also this turbulent solution tends to zero exponentially. So now let us come to the case of an exterior domain. And what we would like to prove in the rest of the lecture is, first, we would like to prove that a solution to the perturbed Navier-Stokes equation in the exterior domain tends to zero as time goes to infinity, and also to prove some decay rate. And we would like to do this also for a suitable weak solution and for a turbulent solution. But all the steps I showed you to generalize the decay properties for a suitable weak solution to the case of a turbulent solution also works for the exterior domain case. So we can focus on the case of a suitable weak solution. And what we proved is that, one more time, you have, in this case, an exterior domain with sufficiently smooth boundary. And you need to assume that you have some additional integrability properties on the force and on the bound and the solution to the Stokes operator B. So you have to assume that F is in some L2 LR space, where R is a little bit less than 2. In some sense, this means a faster decay at spatial infinity. Of course, if the integrability constant is less, so if R is smaller than 2, that means that the solution in some sense decays faster at spatial infinity. And you also have to assume that the function B is an L4, L2R, so also there, a faster decay at spatial infinity, as well as in some LS1, LQ0 space, where S1 is less than S0, and so you have a little bit faster decay in time infinity for the solution to the Stokes equation. And then we were able to prove that the solution V tends to zero as time goes to infinity in the L2 law. What's the idea of the proof? One more time, we have started with the same construction method and start with the differential inequality. And you remember, what you would like to do, or what we have done in the bounded domain case, is to replace this term here by using the Poincaré's inequality. And this is something we cannot do in the exterior domain of case, of course, because we have no Poincaré's inequality. So the only thing we can do with this term is just to forget about this term and neglect this on the left-hand side. And what we were doing is to add this term we would like to have, this rho times the norm of vk in the L2 norm squared, to add on both sides. So let us erase this term, gradient of vk, and add this rho times vk on the left-hand side and on the right-hand side of the equation. And then what we have to do is, of course, we are doing the same trick. We are replacing the rho by some suitable constant and integrate from 0 to t. And on the right-hand side, we can use Duhamel's formula to estimate this vk. And maybe it's easy to see that if you would like to prove some decay properties of this, you have to assume a little bit more than just to assume the same properties you need to assume for B and capital F if you would like to prove the existence of a weak solution. You just have to assume a little bit more, a little bit faster decay, and therefore you have to assume that B is an L4 L2R and capital F is an L2 LR, so that the decay is a little bit faster. And I already told you that we were able, of course, to generalize this decay properties of a suitable weak solution to the case of a turbulent solution just by using exactly the same steps as in the bounded domain case. But all of these theorems we used over there are also working for the exterior domain case. So we have to assume everything like in the case for the decay of a suitable weak solution in the boundary in the exterior domain case, but we just have to add that the force is at least eventually in some LS not half, AQ not half space, so that we were able to construct a strong solution, at least in the time interval from capital T to infinity, or in some time interval T not to infinity, if the data became small enough. And finally, we would like to prove some decay rate for a suitable weak solution and a turbulent weak solution in the exterior domain case. And therefore, we have to assume a lot of more integrability properties of the data. The first one is we have to assume that B is a weak solution to the Stokes equation. So we have to assume some information about the gradient of B. In fact, we need to assume that gradient of B is in some LS1, LQ1 space, where 2 over S1 plus 3 over Q1 is equal to 2. And we have to assume some information about the convective term rewritten in B, so that B times gradient of B is an L1 with values in L2. And finally, we also need some information about the derivative of capital F, that this is an L1, L2 function. And then we were able to prove that the solution V, there's a 2 missing in the L2 norm, tends to 0 in a polynomial way to the power, so it can be estimated by some constant C times T to the power of minus alpha, where alpha depends on a lot of quantities. And to explain all of them, let me erase this assumption on the data over here, just by this dot, dot, dot. And now I would like to explain the quantities in the definition of the minimum, in the definition of alpha. So of course, it's clear what the 3 over 4 means. The S of B is the following. You need to assume, furthermore, that B is in some LQ2 space. And the cell number of this space, so 2 over S2 plus 3 over Q2, is denoted by S of B. And the decay rate depends on S of B minus 5 over 4. Just to have in mind, if we choose S and S2 and Q2 equal to 4, so what you already have on hand, then this just gives you this 5 over 4, so no decay. And if you have some larger index S of B, so some lower integrability properties, then you have the decay. And of course, the quantity S of capital F is the same. It's just some Serre number for the force capital F. What is alpha 1? I already told you that in the exterior domain case, you were able to prove that every weak solution to the Stokes equation tends to 0 in the L2 norm as time goes to infinity for every suitable initial value U naught. But you were not able to calculate some decay rate to this problem for general initial value U naught. And of course, you cannot expect that the solution to the Navier-Stokes equation or to the perturbed Navier-Stokes equation goes to 0 faster than the solution to the linear problem. So also, how fast the solution to the linear problem goes to 0 is part of the definition of alpha. And finally, there's also that all of the quantities you have here behind this dot, 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 so the gradient of capital F, the gradient of B, and the convective term in B, of course, they were going to 0 as if you just integrate from T over 2 to T, plays a role in the decay rate of your weak solution. Okay, and as you see in the how the theorem is stated, the proof of this is rather technical, and I won't be able to show you the main idea, at least the main ideas of the proof here in this, just in this 15 minutes talk. But I would like to show you, in some sense, why you cannot be better than the 3 over 4. Or at least with our methods, how we prove that we cannot be better at the 3 over 4. If you would like to estimate this V of T, or in an approximate process, some Vm of T, you have on the right-hand side of the inequality some term of which looks like that one over here. And then you were able to use this decay properties of the semigroup to the Stokes operator, that you can estimate this term over here by something like that, by some constant time t to the power of minus 3 over 4. This is because of the smoothing or the decay properties of the Stokes operator, times the L2, L3 norm of V squared if you just integrate from T over T to T. And then, of course, the L3 norm in space, you can estimate with the L2 norm in space times the L6 norm in space, both with the factor 1/2. And the L2, L6 norm you can estimate by the Lehre-Hopf class, the data. So finally, you are left with some constant, which depends on the data, times t to the power of minus 3 over 4, times v in the L2, L2 norm, if you just integrate from t over 2 to t. But you know, furthermore, since v is in the Lehre-Hopf class, that this is bounded in L-infinity L2. So the L2, L2 norm, if you just integrate from t over 2 to t, can just grow like some t to the power of 1/2. But this now you can plug in our but then you can put this into this equation here, that this one here is just growing like t to the power of 1/2. And you see that this implies that Vm of t, which is on the left-hand side of the whole of the inequality, I didn't present it to you here, is can be estimated by t to the power of minus 1 over 4. And then you can start an iteration process. Because if you know that V of t in the L2 norm can be estimated by t to the power of minus 1 over 4, then you can prove that the L2, the norm L2 in time L2 in space, if you just integrate from t over t to t, can just grow like t to the power of 1 over 4. So in some sense, we have an improvement of this quantity over here. And then you can do the same trick. You can insert the t to the power of 1 over 4, so this one over here into there, and you see that you have a decay property like t to the power of 1 minus half. And if you plug in that, then you see that V is bounded in L2, L2. And so you can have, so you're left with this property over here, this t to the power of minus 3 over 4. And at least if you just want to do this, this way how to prove the decay properties using the Duhamel's formula and just using the decay properties by the Stokes semigroup, you cannot do better. So if you would like to prove a sharper decay rate or a better decay rate, you have to think about a totally new concept how to prove the decay. And finally, I would like to mention that, of course, you can also do the same for an arbitrary turbulent solution. Because one more time, the idea to generalize from a suitable weak solution to the turbulent weak solution holds for the bounded domain case as well as the exterior domain case. Just by constructing after some time t naught a suitable weak solution which tends to zero as we would like to have, so in this polynomial decay rate, and we have to prove the existence of a strong solution and some serine-type uniqueness theorem, that all of them coincide, and so also the turbulent solution has this desired decay properties. Thank you very much for your attention.